I want to use a few minutes in the time that we have to touch on a topic that God has given us to look at for the year. And the topic is a pure heart. You know, and when we hear words like this, a pure heart, and what is the purpose of a pure heart, is because somewhere along the line, God wants us to concentrate and look at the pureness of heart and the reason why we should have a pure heart. Amen? But today, because of time, and I wouldn't be able to get into certain things, I just want to use, in my own words, have a heart. You know, it's a term that we use all the time and loosely. But what does it really mean if somebody tells you, have a heart? Oh God, have a heart, man. And sometimes we hear persons will say to, you see that person, them have real belly, man. Now they speak of belly, but we know that is not physical we're speaking about, amen? When you refer to somebody, you see that mother, she has real belly. You see that woman? She has real guts. Hear that? She good. You see that man? He has real heart. And this is what we hear person often say. And what is they really referring to? Because if somebody say have a heart, they mean that person should have some love. Yeah? They should have some consideration. They should be able to care. They should be acting kind. And that's what I mean by when you say, have a heart. That person should be able to forgive. So all of these will describe someone who say, have a heart. So tell somebody they say, have a heart. Yeah. Have a heart. And you know what you mean by that, because you know a scripture would say that the same thing you wish for others, you wish for yourself. And that's why we hear this famous, love the Lord thy God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as you love yourself, or love your neighbor as I love you. Because the perfect example when it comes to love is Jesus Christ. So when it says, love your neighbor as I love you, no greater love of any man than one who can lean on his life or his friend. So praise the Lord. Now I want to go to a scripture here. And the reason, let's look at, I think, 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 14. Just that verse, because remember, we want the 1 Samuel 13 verse 14. Remember, we want to circle around having a heart. How do we see someone that has a heart? And what is interpreted by having a heart? And this is what we want to come to in the short moments that we have today. So church, have a heart. 1 Samuel 13 and verse 14.
It is the Lord.
So God himself is establishing here that he has sought a man to mean it is very possible for us to have a heart. It is possible for us to have the heart of God or the mind of God. David, and if we read again, we will see where David come from and what God says about him here in this verse as having a heart or a heart after myself. And this is God Almighty, creator, maker of the universe and all good things that say in such a word. So we know when God pronounces something is no idle boast. God is then boasting on a man who is somewhat like myself and you, or you and I. And God is saying, he is a man after my own heart. And now, if we honestly think about it, we know when God says something like this, it means if a man have a heart after God's own heart, we're looking at perfection. Not so? Yeah. If we say God say that he has a heart after me because God is perfect, we are looking at God saying then, have a perfect heart. And all that is good will come with it. All that is loving will come with that heart that man possesses. All that is caring will come with that heart. All that is kind and goodness and all that is joyful. And joyful to the things that are right. Because remember, in I think 1 Corinthians 13, when it speaks of love, love will not boast itself over sin. Hallelujah. But love is the righteousness of God. And that's the agape love we are speaking to. Praise God. So, if we're looking at the perfection of God, and to see that worked out, then we can know that that person have a heart. And we're talking about the heart like with what God is speaking to here that David would represent. Now, again, one of the things is that we know the life of David. And to many of us, he was a murderer. Because it's he sent you right to the hottest part of the battle so he could be killed to cover up taking Uriah's wife. Amen? So, he was also an adulterer. Now that was the first thing everybody would remember about David. Right? That is the sin that we're throwing them for because he committed adultery. But yet this is the same man God is referring to as a man after my own heart. A man that is sealed with perfection. And he has a heart that goes after me or wants to do the things that I would do. He wants to say the things that I would say. He wants to behave as I would behave. This is the man God is referring to. So tell somebody again, have a heart. Yeah, have a heart. And we know that heart that we're speaking of here is this heart that God is referring to. Now, what happens sometimes with this heart to be seen to show up in our life is we got to wait on our anointed. We got to wait on our anointed. And if we look at a man who waited on his anointed, we'll see again David himself. So let's look at, I think, 1 Samuel 16. Amen. And verse 13. Now hear what it says here. I'm going to read it for the interest of time. Then Samuel, who was the prophet of God, amen, sent on the directions of God through his Holy Spirit to do a work in the house of Jesse. The word say that this Samuel took the horn by oil, not by direction. Samuel, the prophet of God, moving it. So God said, get your horn, put oil in it and move, because I wanted to go down to Ramah, amen, in the house of Jesse. And there's one there, I want you to anoint him king. So, what would a faithful steward do? Just what the master said. That's it. Obey him instructions. That's right. So Samuel took up his horn, went up the house of Jesse, and the word says here, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward to. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Now you know what the word said? That very day, as he was anointed, this David, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day onward or forward. So it is God that anoints us for good things. But if we back up a bit, because it didn't just happen all like that too. There was something that went down in the house. Verse 7 says, and just to capture a bit, in the same chapter 16, 1 Samuel, but the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance, nor on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord said not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but God looketh on the heart. So here it was, as Samuel went to the house of Jesse, he announced why he came. So, in saying that I've come because God has identified one of his sons to be king, and I came to anoint him to show that the Spirit of God would be upon him from this day forward, as we read earlier on. Well, the normal thing is that, as far as he's concerned, he bought his best son. The one that looked well, maybe spoke well, maybe eat with knife and fork, you know, sit at the table well, and all of that, and you know, was handsome and tall and so on and so on. You ladies might be the ones that say what that man really looked like. God have a picture in mind. So he bought this son, and God said to Jesse, no, I don't know. Because I refuse, he's not here looking at. He said, men looking at the outward appearance, but I looking at the heart. And the word went on that they bought several of the sons of all of the sons of Jesse. And God said, I have chosen none of them. So Samuel went on, Jesse, these is all the children you have. I hear all thy children. And what he said? He remember like that something in the back of his head. He had a thing real hard. It's not one that really feeling about. I don't think he matters. He just see about the sheep. Jesse moving and said, by the Spirit of God said, send a picture. And they went for the boy. Well, they had time to clean him up. They had time to bathe him. They had time to, you know, to put perfume and let him smell sweet and all of that. They had time to put a good suit on him or nothing. Just as he is, Rudy. Looking maybe like a disaster to the eyes. Smelling a sheep. Maybe has some fall over him still. And all of that. And as he come, God say, arise and anoint him. I found a man after my heart. Because I ain't looking at the outward. So it didn't matter what David looked like. Maybe it didn't matter what David sung like, but God is looking at David's heart. God said, somebody would run for me. Somebody would die for me. And one of the greatest things why God allows someone like David to step into that place is because David never, even though he committed adultery and murder, he never idolized. See, idolatry, he never committed idolatry. And this is what God wants. And so God looking at the heart that is set on him and will not move regardless. So that is why he can append things like, The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And go down to say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. I still stay with God. And most when Psalm 27, he said, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? David did not fear. He remained with God. And we know stories about David. David had run-ins. David had problems. But you see, to qualify for a heart after God or have a heart doesn't mean it comes without pain and suffering and hardship. But you, what God's looking for is that you're steadfast and unmovable. You know, if you jump out to Job, you know, Job 1:1, I think it is. God identified Job. God showed up Job to the devil. And the devil decided, I don't like that. From the very beginning, the devil didn't like that. Imagine God made the devil bright, anointed cherub. You know, one was there, and the Lord said, beautiful, perfect. And when God made man, he said, let us make man. And hear what killing the devil up to now. After our image and after our likeness, the devil couldn't take that. I mean, I am the anointed cherub. I am the covering. I just take care of the night darkness. You know, so I've given authority. I've given power. You're making something that the word say lower than an angel. And yet, you say to such a person, he is in the image and likeness. But I don't have time to go there. But I'm just telling you how we become enemies of Satan. And I didn't stop there. He keeps trying. You know, in John 10:10, I think it says, the only reason the devil came is to kill, steal, and to destroy. He doesn't want us to have a heart. He doesn't want us to possess a heart after God. So I was saying in Job, hear what it said. Job was, I love this. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. I love that. So God is speaking here about Job and said this man was perfect and he feared God and he hated evil and he was upright. But the devil came. When God called an assembly, the word said the devil was among the sons of God when God called them. And God said, but Satan, where are you here? Well, if you know Satan, he boasts, he bold face, he brass face, and he doesn't fear anyone. It seems like he don't even fear God. How many times is he Satan like challenging God? One time he said, when Jesus was going to cast out the demon out of the man that was lunatic. And they cried out and they said, well, why you come to destroy us before our time? They said that. He knew how to play words. Did God say, according to the Eve story, and Adam? Did God say that thou shalt not eat? And he plays with words to cause us to disobey God, to think differently of God, to discredit God. He said, what I tell you, to eat, because you're going to be like God. So the only reason he said, don't eat is he don't want you to be like him. But God has already blessed man if they understand with all spiritual blessing according to Paul record in heavenly places. Is there anything too hard for God to do? So that's why God could have gone up and out of the house of Jesse, find a man like David who is after his own heart and walk with him. As I said, we numbered all the faults David had in him, but God could have worked with him. See, you know what? The heart. That is the important thing in all of us. If we have that heart, I think it is Proverbs that say, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And this is what we got to look at our brothers and our sisters. Not to look at one another with the eyes to bring them down, to cause them more pain and more hurt. But God has given us the ministry of what? Reconciliation. Yes, God has given us that. Knowing, he said that if one is overtaken in a fault, either the spiritually minded, what to do? Restore such a person in the spirit of humility, meekness, kindness, love. Restore them. Not bitterness. Not bad mouthing. And this is what God is looking for. Person who, without God, you wouldn't be perfect. But thank God, he married to the backslider. You know, case is that the prodigal son we always speak of. And we see the prodigal son requested of his father all that was belonging to him. And he would go out in a far place, a far country, and squander everything that he had. But thank God for the love of a caring father. You know, as the word say, because of who we are, God saying that we who are earthy and we know to give good gifts to our children, much more I, says God. So the prodigal son went out and squandered himself, but thank God for a heart that prays our God, a heart that is sprinkled with the blood and shed. You know, it's not just the word said that the lamb was slain before the foundation of this world. So that is why you could see men through the ages before Jesus even was placed on the cross having such a heart that God requires of man. So because of that, the word said, and this is my parents, we must treat children good. The word said, grow them up in the fear of the Lord, so that when they get older, they will be part from it. So this son going out and doing all what he might tell him to do. But he ended up in a position that he couldn't help himself but thinking of the goodness of his father and what his father was doing for me right now while I'm here. Suffering in pain, languishing in craziness. He could have think, and I mean he could think for a while, for some days, maybe months. According to saying, you and I know, sometimes we just longing and be thinking, why I don't have to be in this position. Better humble myself and go home and tell my mother and my father, sorry, I don't want to stay cool here. I don't want to break through or find somewhere to sleep or find something to see how I can make up or maybe tempted them to teach them. And all the rest of it, because this is what happened. He reached there. Even the custom and all, he had to break it because he ended up with swines, feeding them, seeing about them, and reaching there. He eating even what they are eating. For he had not anything else for himself. And the word of God says, he arrives to himself and he said, I'm going back home. And I'm going to tell daddy, I ain't no big man again. I'm sorry, pardon me for what I have done. And look, even that's not a bit for what I had so bad. For that servant and them grand things nice for them. And it's my daddy doing that. So I'm going back home. And even though they go one of that because I was a bad son, and maybe you decide that you write me off as a son, but just take me in as a hand. So I condemn to that. And we know what the word said, the reason says. That father didn't sleep. That father was always looking out for his son. This one that he thought died, quite gone far, and no communication. So there's a period, there's a window that God has for all of us. And we too must be working with God to give our children that window, to give our friends that window, and give those who we hate the window. For God's sake, we must love those that hate us, those that revile us, those that persecute us, those that willfully use us. For Jesus was able to say, "Forgive them, O my Father, for they know not what they have done." And we see that kind of that love, or that kind of heart, even in Stephen being stoned to death. And he did not charge them. He wasn't worried. He wasn't trying to defend. He was preaching the gospel. And the more they stole him, the more gospel preached. The best sermon ever preached by Stephen was on that day when he was stoned. And stoned to what? Death. So sometimes having a heart of God does not mean that you are going to, God is just going to take you out of the difficulty. You know? You might have to die. But he died steadfast. He died still forgiving and loving and preferring the saints. Or preferring those that didn't understand to become in the household of God. So he said, "Lay not this to the charge." A man was able to say that. So it's possible in all of us. We too can say things like those, or we too can act like those. You know, somebody might say, "I'm only speak of men." But there were women who also was able to possess the heart of God. Tell somebody about Jezebel had a heart. Not so? Rahab had a heart. The word said when the men of God went into that city, Rahab was there in that city, not so? And you know she lived a colorful life, so she was a liked person. Because of her behavior in life. Nevertheless, she recognized God and God people and God work and God doing. And sometimes, just like the ass, the animal, could recognize God and God could work through. Anybody, you could say, I could say, we write them off and they had heart. But they had heart. But God didn't write them off. Rahab was remembered. Her name is written among the heroes of faith because of the work that she did, even in the state, while all around was saying she's a prostitute. Some of you have seen again, more men she sees, so the more men she wants. But no, we saw the heart of Rahab. God saw the heart. We look at the outward. The why, we don't even know. But we saw the act. And remember that woman as well? When men bought her and stole her? Because what? She committed an act again? Act. So men said, destroy her. The Lord said, stone her to death. And Jesus wrote on the ground, and everybody walked away. That way he goes, everybody walked away. And he looked up and he saw the woman and he said, "Woman, where are your accusers?" He said, "Well, I see none of them again." He said, "Well, you go and say no." And this is how the life is. Mary and Martha, the word said, Jesus went to visit them. But what Mary did? She sat at Jesus' feet to hear what he would be saying. While Martha was busy, crumbled the word said, doing all kind of things. Jesus come and cook for him. He might be like fried fish and cuckoo and callaloo, and I don't know. And she was busy preparing. And she got annoyed. You know, some people here in me, some don't really understand your hopefully Lord. They just get annoyed and they just tell you certain things. Oh, what you again? Something that comes from your husband. Something that comes from your wife. Something that comes from your children. Oh, God, mommy, I feel like they're running behind. And they're self-satisfied, running behind them people. But you know the virtue you're getting in your home. And this is what you want to pass on to your husband, to your wife, to your children, that they too will find the love and the joy you found in Jesus, so that they too will walk with you. And the family that prays together stays together. So the words say, Mary decided to stay with Jesus and hear what he was saying, and one chose otherwise. A lot of hope doesn't mean, and you know, good hope doesn't mean that you are with Jesus. But we are saved to do good work, eh? But good work with all Jesus, as good as it is, as needed and necessary as it is, it doesn't guarantee your salvation. You know, I said this already, I think, in the church. Some years ago, an incident took place next door to her in Jordan Tracy. And short as a candidate is that this animal, a cow, fell in, assisted, and was drumming in the field, in the cesspit. And there were a number of folks there who were God-fearing, who loved God, and we can't deny that because they're in church every, you know, they're living a life in church. And they go into church and they speak well, and they will tell their children and their own children and bring them up in the family and all of that. And they were there. But maybe they didn't know what to do at that point in time when the cow was drumming. Or maybe they feared to do it because they would have to, in some cases, bring themselves right down. And we have no repetition. You ever hear Jesus say that? Because of who they want to now represent. Sometimes they have a heart. It will be looked at in a certain way. Because people find the advantage of you. They take advantage over you. Says, when you alone, you can see yourself. Every time we have something on book, they call you on me to pray. Says, when you alone, can pray. And a number of things like that. And they're not seen, so that you are not seen, is God will be using you, allowing you to be there, so he can walk through you. So coming, drumming, and that is the sound echoing all over, all the coming, drumming. And a guy who will refer to as a piper, and nobody had tested you, and all kinds of names and whatever, he's the one that end up being the hero of the day. He's the one that gave his life for coming that day. Because he went down into the pits like Jesus went down into hell. And he rose again triumphantly. So the man went down and he put the cow on his shoulder and brought Kobe out so that others could assist Kobe to live. That's something we have had. Now, I might have been there, and I know for sure I wasn't dying with him. No, sister. It's real. But how come this man, my God, really has to be a God that is supernatural to move in somebody like that, to do an act like that to him? So that is why it's not impossible for David, who was a murderer, an adulterer, and all of that, for God to use him because God saw the intent of the heart. Now everybody else was thinking of him, would it? But they wanted the cow to live. They hope by some miracle, by saying their prayer, you know, who try all kinds of different things to try and get him out. But he would. But the one God worked through But not the work to be done by, but the one who went down. And here now, that's why they speak of experience as the greatest teacher. One who went down in the grind. He knew what it feels like to go in assessment. He knew what it feels like for Phil to be covering him from head to toe. He knew what it feels like, the weight of the cow on his shoulder and bring it up. He knows. So the word. The word for us today is have a heart. We all know to have a heart. Or even if it wasn't for God, it was on our side. Or little David, who wrote all those lovely songs, make all those musical melodies, who played his harp so skillfully and so well, we would not have been able to stand up to the test of time. So without God, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, love your neighbor as I love you. Let your whole heart, mind, body, soul, and spirit be speaking of the things of God. The word says, and they come that close, Matthew 6 and 33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So that is how we will get to that place where we possess a perfect heart and a heart after God's own heart. Jesus came for all, and he could use all of us, any one of us. It was the rather of the sin, the death story of the sinner, that all of us will come to know who God is. And that's why Jesus stayed from afar and knew that I must go through Samaria. They must get the message. They must get the love. They must see the heart of a man that came to represent God. And the verse when he went there, he met the woman that was a cast out. But in conversation, he realized she had a heart that could manifest all the qualities of God. She is the one who ran after she received a drink of the water of life. Come and see a man. Now tell me all about my business. Is not this the Christ? I bless God for today. I hope that God will continue our lessons on a pure heart, the purpose of a pure heart, because God wants us to have the purest of heart. He died that we might live. Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.